you support healthy, active transportation for people of all ages and abilities, specifically in Inglewood and Ramsey. And I'm going to draw. Sure. How will you support healthy, active transportation for people of all ages and abilities in Inglewood and Ramsey? So there's some wiggle room to interpret what healthy, active means, and that's part of the benefit of these audience questions. So I'm going to ask this person to begin with that. Cheryl, please answer that question. How will you support healthy, active transportation for people of all ages and abilities in Inglewood and Ramsey?
I get all the good questions. Okay, healthy, active, that would mean maybe riding your bicycle or walking or being in a wheelchair. And as someone that's been through a couple of hip surgeries in the last 8 years, I'm very aware of my mobility and the ability to get around. And it's really important, I guess, to maintain our bicycle paths. And that means clearing them in the winter, keeping them up to date in the summer, and a walkable community. And I guess we're going to be, it's going to be interesting to square the circle, because this council and councillor have opted to have the rapid bus transit zooming down 9th Avenue, which will take away the bike lane, and there'll be very fast buses, big buses, so we'll be in a bit of a challenge to navigate our sidewalks, our streets when it gets icy in the winter. So I think we just have to do our best to maintain what we have in terms of infrastructure.
And no, Stephanie, I didn't write that one, but I'm happy to respond to it. Part of great neighborhoods are building a city that's much healthier for all of us. Although the research is showing that we spend way too much time sitting around, not moving, and we've designed moving out of our communities. One of the core tenets of great neighborhoods is that we have to get back to building great neighborhoods where you can walk, where you can learn, where you can go to work, where you can shop, all of these things within a walkable environment. East Calgary neighborhoods have that footprint, and it's a question of stopping the distillation of our taxes to automobile habitat on the edge of the city and reinvesting, and that's exactly what we're doing. So the Green Line is a major, major piece of connection to the rest of the city. It's going to be one of the big bones on which we build the rest of the city. And what's happening just over by the Blackfoot truck stop up into the communities of Greater Forest Lawn is another major transit piece. These are hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars in investment that were not on the radar and are now happening because of the work we did as a community, talking about a better relationship with the rest of the city, and we're executing on those things. The other thing, of course, is cycle infrastructure. We changed the game in Calgary with cycle infrastructure, and all of the Green Line, the route up to International Avenue, all of these things are including multi-use paths. So you're going to be able to ride along the Green Line on a multi-use path. 12th Street is going to become a multi-use path onto the bridge system, which is going to have better pedestrian and cycle facilities than ever before. The shutdown of the bike path to build the Zoo Bridge has shown us what an important bike corridor 8 is, and we're going to make that more and more of a bike corridor connected to 12th and the Green Line and connected to the route up to International Avenue. Over the next 4 years, we have to find the next tranche of money to connect all of International Avenue down to the truck stop with the Green Line station, and I'm committed to doing that. And that's all about creating healthy, active, amazing communities where we can do all of those things.
Your position on secondary backyard suites in Inglewood and Ramsey. And I would encourage the respondents to dig deep and go into the nuances of this community and secondary suites. And the name I've chosen to start this is Cecil. What is your position on secondary backyard suites in Inglewood and Ramsey?
Too loud.
Okay. So on secondary suites, on the
the back of their houses. I think the foremost thing to take into account here is safety. Why hasn't this been a done deal so far? It's because of the safety issue. I think they're looking at it to see that people, foremost, are safe, mostly from rather like economic point of view. So my issue would be, yes, go ahead with it, as long as it's safe, and as long as it is not perjuring anybody in the next to you. So that would be my position on that. I will be for it, but we have to keep the safety in place, whether it's a fire check on the houses and on the secondary suites, and that will be the first most issue in order to go forward. Thank you.
So with the planning committee in Bridgetown, we've been dealing with secondary suites quite a bit, and I am actually for secondary suites. I think if they're done right and they're done well, they can provide more eyes on the street. It can be another active corridor for pedestrians, if you include walkability, lighting, all of those kinds of things, so that you are pushing some of the vagrants out of the alleys and from behind your houses. But I also believe that there needs to be parking associated with it. People that live in these places have vehicles. I walk to work every day, but I come home, I have three kids, and we drive all over the city. We need our vehicles. We don't have a grocery store in Bridgetown, so we need to drive to go get food. For five people, that fills my car, so I can't take my groceries on there on transit. I think it's a good way to increase density without having that high rise blocking out the sun kind of feel that some of these main streets initiatives are going to put in on our main corridors. I think that it needs to be done well and done right, so it can be done for positive growth.
For me, I support this idea, but I have a feeling that we only talk about Inglewood and Ramsey. I guess it's the capital city of Ward 9, but we have more than these two areas in this ward, right? So let's talk about other areas. Let's talk about the general map of Ward 9, not just focusing on only Ward 9, but on the people of Ward 9, yes, they support these ideas, such as even the people from other communities like Pembroke and Forest Lawn, they all also support these ideas. But some of these people, yes, they love the idea, but they don't have the capacity of doing it. So I can see why we are just focusing on Inglewood and Ramsey. But in short, I support the idea, but it's up to the property owners to add a secondary suit in her or his house or her house, so it's a good idea. Why not? Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. The next question is a little wordier, so it's about community consultation. Community associations attempt to be educated about issues in which they are stakeholders, and they try to establish informed positions. Some community associations have reported being ignored and or circumvented in their consultation process. So the question to the candidates tonight is, should it be mandatory for the candidate and elected officials to register the formal response statements from community associations or the position of their community associations on an issue before city council takes to a vote on that issue? So should a councillor have to acquire and register the formal position of a community association before city council collectively votes on that issue? And the candidate who will answer this first is John Carlin.
Right.
I'm very glad to be able to answer that. My entire perspective on city building was shaped by the work that was done in this neighborhood to save it from imminent destruction in the 1960s. And the work that Jack Long did, which was an echo of the work that Jane Jacobs did, is now considered best practices. I came to City Hall with a 5-point transformation of City Hall called Great Neighborhoods. Point two is that neighborhoods have to be deeply involved in decision-making processes, and we have to actually devolve the right level of decision-making to the right level of decision-making authority. Our community associations in Calgary have a remarkable amount of influence on development issues, on city change issues, and they have a really proud history of positively impacting how we've grown our city. Having said that, as the president of the community association for 7 years here, I always said that community associations have no formal power. They have influence, and that influence is directly commensurate with how thoughtful and rational and reasonable they are. And when they bring that to the table and how representative they are and how much they are brokers of broad community conversations that need to be had. And so my mission has always been to have community associations do that. Now, having said that, communities are more than just the people who live there. They're the businesses that operate there, they're the institutions that operate there. And Great Neighborhoods posits that you have to get those three groups together, talk about where you've come from, talk about where you're at, and rather than be victims of change, drive the kinds of changes that you want to see. We are doing that work in so many important ways. The Community Representation Framework Task Force is currently producing work and is going to start engaging people on the other side of the election to talk about what the next generation of community association could and should look like, and working with communities across the city to set up more formalized approaches.
Okay, my heart's racing because I think that the experience of this community is not just what was just spoken about there. People have signed 1,100 signature petitions when it comes to building an overhyped building on 9th Avenue, and it fell on deaf ears. You know, the fix is in. And this counselor sat with the on the other side of the table in opposition to the community that he represents. So to suggest that the community associations and the community have input is absolute, in my experience, and I think a lot of us in this room, I call it nonsense. And I can see by the look on some of your faces that we all feel the same. We don't feel represented. And I think my entire platform is based on bringing respect back to the citizens and the community associations, because from what I've heard and understood is that there's actually a move to take the community associations out of these decision-making powers. And so this comes down to trust. You know, we know the record, we've lived it, we've lived it for 7 years, so it's up to all of you to decide whether you actually trust that this is going to be, you know, the situation going forward. Thank you.
Yes. On my part, I feel the same way. You only have to go around the neighborhoods of the Ward 9, whether it's Forest Lawn, Forest Heights, Dover, Erin Woods, you will see the associations, the buildings are all very dilapidated. It doesn't look like somebody's taking care of us. It doesn't look like somebody is actually going there, getting things done, working with people, engaging the residents, setting programs for the youth to get out and do something, rather than just wander around with wanting something to do. So I do agree. I mean, we have the 7 years of our counselor, and while I thank you for all your hard work and everything, I think there's more that we can do in the Ward 9, respectfully, and I think that's why we're here, because we care about the people that live in the areas, and we want to do something about it. So that's what I want to say. Thank you.
I'd
Actually, last time I checked, one line has almost 78,000 people in this world. And like just in England, there's almost 4,000, and Ramsey almost 2,100. But what I heard from the council is that like it's like beating the chest about how like the whole charade or when talking about the Green Line project, or, like we met almost everybody, we consulted people in this area. But if I look when I look at the people who came to attend these meetings, on average, if say like if there were like four or three meetings, on average there were only 150 people coming to these meetings. And if you look at 7,000-8,000 people, only 150 people who came to this meeting, I think that's not enough. And I mean, if that was me, I mean, I'll be ashamed of like beating my chest up. Yes, granted, with the people, did this with the people. No, no. We need to bring more people in the equation when it comes to such big project like Green Line project, because it will affect a lot of like historical sites. The environment. The people need to be involved. And I would think like only the people living in Ramsey and England are just. It's what we care about. But there's so many people out there, so many people. I've seen these people. Actually, like they have no idea if there's any politicians in this town anymore, because they never see anyone coming to their houses. I think the councillor will agree with me that, I may be wrong. I don't know if he never even went to the Pembroke areas or Forest Lawn areas, but these areas, they are terrible. The people in there are suffering. So I think that we need to do more to bring people into the equation and talk with them. Thank you so much.
My comment is that I would love to see the community associations and especially the planning committee have more power with council. I feel like they're not being listened to. In Bridgeland, you know, we have our planning meetings, and at the end of the day, I think we feel, you know, completely powerless that, okay, we're going to write this letter, but who knows, you know, what's going to happen. Well, it'll probably go through. Yeah, okay. Right? I mean, and I'm sorry, but Giancarlo has a vision for our communities that maybe isn't what the residents actually have as a vision. I don't want to live in New York. I don't want 9-story buildings down First Avenue in Bridgeland. You know, I want to keep the character of my neighborhood, and I want to see how the density that they've already planned for the bridges, how that gets built out. I want to see how it affects safety, how it affects traffic, how it affects livability. I want to see more services in my community. And I'm sure you feel the same way, because when General Hospital was blown up and that Milan was redeveloped, we lost a pool, we lost an outdoor ice rink, we lost two ball diamonds, and what did we get in return? We have a LRT station for a community association that doesn't make sense for anyone. You know, the planning needs to make sense. We need time to develop our area redevelopment plan. We need, as a community, to decide where does the density go and where doesn't it, and what does that look like for us. And we need city to listen.
Some of the candidates tonight said they wanted to cut taxes. How do they plan to maintain, and do they think that it's important to also maintain and grow services, fight crime, etc.? And if so, how do they plan to maintain achieve those objectives if they do in fact cut taxes? And the person who will answer this first is Stephanie. Sure. Some of the candidates tonight said they want to cut taxes. How do they plan to maintain and grow services, fight crime, etc., if they do cut taxes? And you're allowed to say whether in fact you agree taxes should be cut.
So I know that a lot of us have talked about cutting taxes, but I think it's more about fiscal responsibility and how we're spending the money that's coming in. I think there's been a lot of waste over the last little while. the money just isn't there for some of these projects that are going through. I mean, the most recent art structure that, I don't know how much we spent, maybe some of that money could have gone for better policing, bike patrols, safety on the streets. I'd like to see community-based plans in place with the residents working together to make sure you're calling 311 every single time, because then they can register it, and if the police know that there's this hot spot, a problem, they will be there. They will register on their map. So it's community-based, but it's also more police officers in the neighborhood. I think crime goes down when you see the police walking around, doing the beat or riding their bikes. We're supposed to have a bike patrol. I think I've seen them once in the last 4 months, so that's not enough. So I think maybe we need more initiatives like that on the street, because my house was broken into twice this year, and my car has been vandalized like half a dozen times. And my neighbor actually had his dad's truck. Someone graffitied it while his dad was visiting his house next door. So crime is real, and it's getting worse, and the economy isn't helping. And I think that needs to be a focus for our council. And if that requires new leadership and more transparency to do it, then so be it.
Recently, in council, there was debate over salaries for councillors. How the recommendations of the committee were handled received unfavorable press. Comment on whether you believe this if so, how you feel the process of reviewing councillors' salaries could be improved. Recently, in council, there was debate over councillors' salaries. How the recommendations of that committee were handled received unfavorable press. Comment on whether you believe this, and if so, if you felt it achieved negative press. If you believe that, and then if so, how you feel the process of reviewing councillors' salaries could be improved. If you think it could be improved.
Yes, we all know that there's always a tendency of government officials to raise their salaries on themselves, and they don't really have to go around and ask the people who sent them there their opinion, whether they agree or not. I mean, the process, first of all, was like poorly run by those who were doing it, and that's why they got negative media. So my point is we have to go to the people. That's my opinion, because a government job is not some lucrative, job. It's a government, but it's the people who are paying for your salaries, and it's up to the people who have to agree whether they support the idea or not. But this is not what we see usually. What we see, all over, actually, it's not just Calgary, it's across Canada, even in Toronto, Toronto City Council, it's the same problem. So just sit down there and, okay, you know what? Yeah, we need extra dollars, and they vote on that, and that's it. So I believe the people need to be involved in this. This is my humble opinion. The people need to be involved whenever there's any idea. Maybe councillors have the right to raise their salaries. Maybe there's so much work. Right now they're saying Calgary is growing, and the one line maybe needs to have two councillors. So that's extra dollars, but there's so much work coming from when the city is growing. So yes, and maybe you're right that yes, they have to raise the salaries, but the people need to be involved. I think that's my opinion on this one. Thank you.
Okay, so for those of you here that aren't familiar, what actually happened is that there was a committee struck. It was volunteer. They had to pay for their own parking. and they were chastised if they were even a couple minutes late. When they went to present their report to council, they sat through an entire day of, as Rick Bell would say, the blue playpen, where they were subjected to a lot of what they would consider trivial issues. When it finally came to them presenting their report, they were treated with absolutely a lack of respect. This council has the highest pay and benefit package in the entire country. So it was reasonable to look to see whether they really needed all these benefits when everyone else in Calgary has taken a bit of a haircut, you know, with this recession. We're all paying for this recession, but City Council seems to think that they're removed from this, and I think the process should have been more respectful. These people worked very hard to take a look at this. They were an intelligent board of hardworking volunteers, and they deserved respect. They weren't given it, and I don't think that being in City Council should be a lifetime career. I, for one, would explore term limits of 2 terms, definitely term limits on all the boards, and so I think it's up to people to come into the real world, get in, do something for your community for 1 or 2 terms, and then leave and let someone else come in and take the reins. This shouldn't be a career. Thank you.
Yes, I'm also aware of the issue that happened with this committee, special committee that was set up to set the salary for the councilors for the following year. And it was very interesting to hear that when it was time for asking the councilors if they would reduce the salary of the mayor, they all agreed, but when it came to them, it was, no, don't touch my money. Actually, there is a video that I have not released on my page, but on there, and this is gonna be news to you, but it is on there, that I'm pledging, or I'm committing, to reduce my salary by 25% in this coming election if I am councillor, and I will work hard with our community and with every community that is pretty much lacking representation, which is a lot of the world, a lot of the communities in the Southeast. Thank you very much.
Well, this was an interesting incident, and I completely agree with Cheryl that the volunteer committee did get treated with a certain lack of respect, and I made those comments in the news. What's important to realize is that the recommendation that they brought before committee or before council was that councillors should be put back in charge of deciding what their pay was. And that just seemed completely anathema to me and all members of council. We asked them, and I had actually the opportunity to ask the first question. When I read that recommendation, I was like, that is absolutely bizarre. The whole point of this committee is to remove questions of pay from the politicians who are getting that pay. And I asked them, what was the rationale? Because I read the report and I did not see a rationale in that report. And they said, well, our rationale is that you should be in charge of your own pay, so you can quickly change your pay. And I said, that's not a rationale, that's the statement of what you think should happen. Why should we do that? And I couldn't get an answer out of them. And so I sat down, and when I sat down, my colleagues on council, the most conservative members of council, the most progressive members of council, called it out as a bad report. And that is humbly what I think is the fact there. And, you know, there was a lot of op-eds, and Rick Bell wrote about it. And, you know, I absolutely believe that our city council should not decide what their pay is. And Caesar, there was no recommendation to change our pay. They said you're getting paid a fair amount. That was the recommendation of the committee, but they said you should be put in charge of whether you're paid a fair amount in the future. And we said, no, thank you. The fact that it got spun the way it got spun is quite interesting. I think there's a lot of misdirection of our discontent taking place, and I look forward in my closing comments to talking about maybe why.
So my closing remarks, I want to thank everybody that made it tonight. I think it's very important that we have these kind of meetings, and not just on election night, every month if possible, with every community that is willing to actually hear the representative, whether it is a weekend or whatever. When people want to do something, they get up and do it. So I thank you very much for being here. Why I'm running for councilor is because I've seen the lack of change in the areas, not just in Ramsey and Inglewood, but all across the Ward 9, from Forest Heights when it wasn't Ward 9, to all the way to Dover and Ogden. So I want to let you know that I'm willing to work with everybody in council and not take sides, not form cliques in city council and just go and do whatever somebody else is doing because it is the hip thing to do or the right thing to say to gain votes or to gain degrees from interest. Why I'm running is because I deeply believe that the people of the Ward 9 can do much more. The youth, the high schools that lack the programs, the lack of programs for the youth in terms of arts and sports and all of that, I think we can do much more for them. And also the infrastructure is just dilapidated. What we've seen in the Ward 9 all these years, I lived there like all my teenage years, adult life, and I haven't seen a very significant change. And that takes a toll on people, that takes a toll on their day, that takes a toll when they go to work, that takes a toll on the kids when they go to school. You know, like it is so connected, it is very holistic what happens in the Ward 9, in the city, you know. So we have to pay attention to that. An issue here resonates over there. So whether it's school programs, whether it's a more sense for recreation, all of that, it resonates, you know. So that is why I'm running for councilor, and I hope you give me a chance. Thank you.
Okay, so let me thank you again for being here this evening. I thank all organizers for this event. I'm running because most people like myself feel like we're being ignored for too long. I've met people all across this world, I mean, including this Ramsey and Inglewood, and most people feel like they're being ignored. The city council is just doing what they're doing and they are not listening to what the people want. And this is why I'm running. Let's try to make sure that every community in this city is secure. Not only the Southwest, you know, what they call the most important people, and ignoring the people in Pembroke, Forest Lawn, and these other communities because maybe they don't matter that much. No, let's make sure that we give a break to business owners, I mean small business owners, property owners in Ward 9 because they are suffering from insecurity, the value of the houses is going down, their business is being broken. So let's make sure that we help those parents, like want to go to school, want to find a job. I mean, we can see help these people by just giving them free daycare, right? I mean, we let these parents sitting in their houses, giving them like other social services, you know. And that's money which we can pay for a free daycare program. And let these parents go to school and maybe go to find a job somewhere. Because once these parents, single parents, go and find a job, it's very uplifting for them. So So there's so much. Please, I ask you, whenever you go out, there's my flyers in the back. Please pick one, and everything is on that flyer, and those are my ideas. And I hope that you can support me and elect me to be your next city council. Thank you again.
Anything for my closing, but what I will say is that I have been to all the communities in Ward 9 now. I love that we've got Calgary East in our ward. It's heartwarming, you know, hardworking people, but you know, these communities have been neglected. We've got a lot of work to do in Ward 9, and I want to represent Ward 9, all of you. You know, this is a very Inglewood centric Ramsey debate, but the reality is that Ward 9 is massive, it's rich, the people are incredible, and I'd be privileged and honored to get to work and, you know, to be representational for all of you. Your voices matter to me. I have no ideological agenda. I'm really here to represent all of you. Thank you very much, and I'm up to the challenge.
Listening to us and for all your great questions. I truly believe that we need more transparency at City Council. We had 748 in-camera meetings over this last term, with 18 in Toronto and 1 in Ottawa. So what is it that our constituents, the people that they represent, can't hear? I want to know that the person I voted for is standing behind what he said to me. So that means less in-camera meetings, more transparency, better leadership. City Council. My goal would be to see constituents have a voice at Council and have fiscal responsibility and that transparent leadership I talked about. I believe that Councillor Carras should not be re-elected. He doesn't ask what people want. He tells them what they need and what he plans for them, and whether they want it or not, because he believes he knows best. It's his vision. And I'm sorry, but his vision for my neighborhood is not mine. He introduces major changes and then he downplays them. He regularly intervenes in site-specific developments in our community with his own agenda and his own plans, constantly encouraging more density, bigger developments. And it's not what we want. It's opposed by the community, and I'm sure we're finding that in other areas around the Ward 9. All that being said, it's my fear that we have too many really great candidates here tonight, and that Giancarlo would end up getting in just by default because we'd split the vote. So after listening to the debate and hearing everyone speak, I'm going to announce that I'm stepping down as a candidate and supporting Cheryl as we share common goals and vision for Ward 9. So I'd like to put all my support, my volunteers, everyone that's already pledged for me, I'm gonna go around and talk to them later this week, and let's band together for change at the City Hall.
Calgary united into one historic landscape in this election. I think it's very important, and I agree that these are neighborhoods that built the city and have been neglected for a long time. And in fact, I went to City Hall to reverse and end that pattern of neglect with hard-fought plans that were developed through deep consultation with all of the neighborhoods. And when I say all of the neighborhoods, I did deep work in Inglewood and Ramsey on this side of the Deerfoot. I also did deep consultation with the communities of Greater Forest Lawn. The $180 million investment that's being made on that avenue is a direct result of work that I started in 2005 with those neighborhoods. Now, great neighborhoods was a huge, huge task. It's an amalgamation of best practice from across North America in terms of transforming our cities from sprawl machines into machines that reinvest in the communities that built these cities. That change is fundamentally underway. We're putting neighborhoods first, engaging in a whole new generation of local area planning, just as a start. Community level governance and putting community voices and getting that right fully underway. Reorging City Hall so we go from, you know, cubicle bureaucrats to interdisciplinary first, you know, interdisciplinary teams of civil servants working at the neighborhood level. Those transformations are underway. Revenue, expenses, taxation regimes, all of these things are deeply engaged. We have the most fiscally responsible council we've had in decades. We've ended the sprawl subsidy. These are huge, huge dollars and cents things, not fractions of pennies gripes. We're charting a new course for Calgary. We have a historic agreement signed with the province that makes us not a service corporation established from on high, but a government of, by, and for the people. This is a 105-year dream of Alberta municipalities, and it's happened in the last 7 years under the most chaotic regime imaginable. We're at a crossroads. I am running for City Hall to make sure that the historic reinvestment and the historic transformations that are taking place continue to land and land well. And I need your support. Please come and talk to me so we can get into these details in a much more substantive way. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone, for being here tonight and for participating. Thank you to the candidates for passionate, informed, and thoughtful presentations and respect for each other and for the democratic process. Good night, everyone.